안녕하세요, 원다입니다. 셰익스피어의 햄릿, 로미오와 줄리엣, 허밍웨이 노인과 바다, 도스토옙스키의 죄와 벌. 그동안 우리나라에서 다른 나라의 고전 문학 작품을 읽고 배우는 건 너무나 당연하다 여겨왔습니다. 하지만 우리나라의 문학 작품이 다른 나라에서 어떻게 가르쳐지고 있는지는 생각해 본 적이 없죠. 다른 나라에서는 우리나라의 문학 작품을 어떻게 가르치고 있을까요?
As you talked about earlier, the cranes represent long life. They represent immortality. They're talking about the immortality of the Korean spirits. We have the author creating this flock of cranes that fly overhead as a very powerful symbol that despite what might happen between the North Koreans and the South Koreans, the Korean spirit must live on.
캐나다 엘버타주 룬드브렉의 한 고등학교 문학 시간, 황순원의 학에 대해 가르치고 있는 알렌 더프리슨 교사. 황순원의 학은 고등학교 국어 교과서에 실려 있는 작품이며 수능 국어 문제로 자주 출제되는 작품이기도 합니다. 1953년에 황순원이 발표한 단편 소설로 6.25 전쟁이 막 휴전으로 치닫던 시기에 쓰여진 작품이며 배경 시기 또한 1953년 그쯤 국군이 북진하고 있던 때입니다. 우리는 학교에서 황순원의 학을 다음과 같은 작품이라고 배웠습니다. 황순원의 학은 성삼위와 덕재라는 두 친구의 이데올로기 대립이나 전쟁 따위로 훼손되지 않는 순수한 우정을 통해 전쟁이라는 비극의 현대사를 사상과 이념을 초월한 인간의 시련으로 극복해 나가야 한다는 작가의 휴머니즘이 담겨있는 소설이다. 줄거리는 다음과 같습니다. 발단, 6.25 전쟁 당시 38선 부근의 북쪽 마을에 국군이 들어온다. 황폐해진 마을에 공포 분위기가 감돈다. 전개, 동네 치안대에서 어린 시절의 단짝 친구인 덕재가 포승줄에 묶인 채 있는 것을 보고 성삼은 깜짝 놀라지만 호송 책임을 맡게 된다. 위기, 성삼은 덕재를 신문하나 덕재는 자신은 농사짓는 재주밖에 없는 사람이라고 말한다. 절정, 벌판을 지나던 성삼은 그곳에서 덕재와 올가미로 학을 잡아서 놀다가 사냥꾼이 나타났다는 말을 듣고는 학이 죽을까봐 풀어주었던 얘들을 떠올린다. 결말, 성삼은 덕재의 포승줄을 풀어주며 학사냥을 제안한다. 덕재는 자신을 몰래 놓아주려는 성삼의 의도를 눈치채고 잡풀 사이로 도망친다. 한국인만이 겪은 분단과 전쟁이라는 특정한 시대적 배경과 사건을 담고 있는 학이라는 한국 문학 작품을 전혀 다른 역사와 사회적 환경 속에서 살고 있는 캐나다 학생들에게 어떻게 가르치는지 몹시 궁금했습니다. 그는 학이라는 작품을 제대로 이해시키기 위해 학생들에게 한국의 조선시대의 철학과 사상부터 가르칩니다. 서양인의 관점에서 도저히 이해할 수 없는 부분에 대해 학생들을 수월한 이해를 돕기 위해서였습니다.
I am, however, going to be talking about Confucianism and several key aspects within it. There are several key tenets in Confucianism. There's no real codified law or list of rules, but there are a series of precepts or guidelines for a Confucius gentleman. Those include the distinction between law and ritual, relationships between family members and strangers, filial piety, loyalty. In Confucianism, it's expected that you've internalized the rules and laws of the country. And you avoid being a criminal. You act as you should be at all times. We all here have fathers and mothers. And to a certain extent, we show our fathers and mothers respect. In Korea, in a Confucius society, today and back during the Joseon Dynasty, it was critically important for you to respect your parents. Critically important. You need to be loyal to your parents. You need to be loyal to your family. You need to be loyal to your country. The Confucius gentleman. The gentleman who embodies all of these ideals is the pinnacle of Joseon society. He needs the proper ritual, piety, and loyalty in all his actions and all his behaviors.
알렌 더프리슨 교사는 캐나다 고등학생들에게 황순원의 학을 설명하면서 그동안 우리가 언급하지 않았던 부분까지 서양인의 관점에서 세세하게 분석하며 해석합니다. 서양인의 관점에서 한국의 작품이 어떻게 분석되고 해석될 수 있는지 공유하고자 이 영상을 번역하여 소개합니다. 함께 보시죠.
And welcome to Korean Literature Weekly. I'm your host, Mr. Alan Friesen. Today we're going to be talking about the short story Cranes or A Crane by Hwang Sun-hwan. Let's talk about first of all the central figure in the central metaphor in this story, which is the crane. In Korean culture, the crane represents immortality and long life. It was believed that the nobles in Korea back in the Joseon Dynasty, if you died, you came back as a crane. They're very noble, very beautiful creatures. It's rumored that they lived 1,600 years. So, we've got this these cranes that are present not just in the title, but also throughout the middle and at the very end of the story. And we've got two main characters here, Sang Sang and Tokche. Again, we, from a Western point of view, if we know all the facts behind the story, we should be scratching our heads right about now. You've got this guy, Mr. Friesen, you're telling me, from South Korea, who's going up into North Korea, who knows a guy from North Korea, and the guy from South Korea is remembering the North Korean guy with kindness. He was a nice guy. Up to this point, everything in the story fits our Western point of view. We have a South Korean guy going into North Korea and capturing one of those evil North Koreans. Yay, America. This makes sense. But then he remembers him with kindness. And later on in the story, we're going to find that the entire morality that we have imposed upon the text becomes inverted. So Song Sam remembers the kindness and he gets upset. He feels this tension between his duty as a South Korean officer and between his memories of this person who was his friend. He says, filled with a sudden surge of unexpected rage, Song Sam shouted, "Hey fellow, how many people did you kill during the war?" He doesn't reply. He doesn't say anything. He's asked again and again. He doesn't say anything. And then he asks, "Why would someone who had been vice chairman of the Peasants League stay put and not run away? Were you hiding for some kind of mission?" So what Song Sam is saying here is, he's saying, you were a political entity in this village. You were important in this village. You knew we were coming. Why didn't you try to escape? And the suspicious mind is immediately thinking, and Song Sam echoes this, are you planning some sort of mission? Were you planning on trying to hide so that you could somehow come into South Korea and wreck our great country? Because South Korea is the good guys, North Korea is the bad guys. This is what we think as 21st century readers. We automatically put that worldview into our minds when we think of North Korea and South Korea. And he doesn't make excuses. "I was made vice chairman of the Peasants League because I was the son of the poorest peasant and reckoned a hard worker. If that's a crime deserving death, well then, okay. Now as before, I'm a guy who stood at nothing but farming. Now father's lying sick at home. It's already been half a year." Song Sam says, "Anyway, didn't you realize what would happen if you stayed instead of running away?" To which Tokche replies, "I was intending to run away. They said that when the Southerners moved north, they would kill every man without exceptions, and they obliged all the men between 17 and 40 to go north. I thought of running away, even carrying father on my back. Then father said no. He said no one ever heard of a farmer planting all his crops, then running away somewhere, leaving everything behind. The reason that Tokche didn't escape was because he was being a good son." This fits right into our notion of an ideal Confucius gentleman. He stayed behind because his father asked him not to. He wanted him to help him deal with the crops because he was sick. And then in the very next paragraph, we get the truth behind Song Sam's story. Back in June, it had been Song Sam's turn to evacuate. That night, he had told his father secretly they should get out. Then his father had said just the same thing. How can a farmer leave his farming and go running off somewhere? Song Sam had left alone. As he went wandering among unfamiliar roads and villages, the thought of the farm work he had left in the hands of his elderly parents and youthful bride never left him. So whereas Tokche stayed behind in order to look after his father and risked capture at the hands of the Southerners, the North Korean government said that they would be killed. He stayed behind because he was a dutiful son. But Song Sam, earlier in the war, had escaped and had gone south and had sought his fortune. And by doing so, he proved himself to be an unloyal son. He proved himself to be outside of this order of Confucianism we talked about earlier. He left his wife and his father behind and only cared about himself. This inverts the moral structure of the story. And at the very end of the story, Song Sam, the Southerner, says, "Let's go crane hunting." He's referring to the time when they were both children and they had secretly captured a crane. And then they had let it go shortly before it had been shot. So he's saying, let's go crane hunting. Why don't you go run over there and see if you can get some cranes to fly out from the ground. He's not telling them to go hunt cranes. He's saying, okay, you know what? This is your chance. Why don't you go run? Why don't you escape? So at the very end of the story, we have this person who is a rebel who betrays his father, betrays his bride. He decides that he can no longer do this to his best friend, and he lets his best friend escape. At that point, just then, a few red-crowned cranes were slowly flying with outstretched wings across the high blue autumn sky. And as we talked about earlier, the cranes represent long life. They represent immortality. And it's my belief that what they're talking about is not the immortality of any of these characters. They're not even really talking about the immortality of North Korea or South Korea. They're talking about the immortality of the Korean spirit. Song Sam realizes that he's made a mistake by breaking these established rules of Korean society. Not North Korean society, not South Korean society, but the essence of Koreanness. He has broken it. And he's trying to mend it by allowing his friend to escape instead of being taken back south, tortured and possibly killed by the South Korean government. And because he does this, we have the author creating this flock of cranes that fly overhead as a very powerful symbol that despite what might happen between the North Koreans and the South Koreans, the Korean spirit must live on.
Nicely done.
지금까지 알렌 더 프리즌 교사의 한국 문학 강의를 들어보았습니다. 참 신선하고 기발한 해석이었습니다. 한국에서는 학을 단순히 보편적인 인간의 시련을 돕는 매개체로 해석하고 있지만 알렌 교사는 학을 더 의미 깊게 해석했습니다. 즉 그는 학이 한국인의 정신을 나타내는 은유로 사용되었다고 분석했습니다. 그래서 작가가 제목도 학으로 설정한 것이라고 해석했습니다. 한국에서는 마지막에 성삼이 덕재를 놓아준 것을 인간이라면 누구나 가지고 있는 보편적인 인간애를 실현한 것으로 해석했으나 알렌 더 프리즌 교사는 유교적 도덕성을 가슴 저변에 내재하고 있는 한국인만의 정신을 실현한 것으로 해석했습니다. 학 두세 마리가 하늘 높이 날고 있다라는 마지막 문장을 한국에서는 덕재가 자유의 몸이 되었음을 암시하는 상징적 결말이라고 해석합니다. 반면 알렌 더 프리즌 교사는 불멸을 상징하는 학처럼 한국인의 정신은 반드시 계속 살아있을 것이다 라는 것을 의미하는 강력한 상징의 메시지라고 해석합니다.
Korean spirit must live on.